Lecture number 28, mechanical measurements. We have been looking at the measurement of velocity of fluids, and we will consider two more techniques which are useful for measurement of velocities of basically liquids and gases, and more suitably we are going to talk about measurement of velocity of a fluid like air, which is very common in most applications. The first instrument I am going to take a look at is the hot wire or the hot film anemometer for velocity measurement. I will go through the theoretical basis for the hot wire, and then I will give an example which describes how it functions and what kind of numbers we can expect. And the second method we are going to take a look at is the laser Doppler velocimeter. The difference between the hot wire and the laser Doppler is that the hot wire or the hot film requires a probe to be inserted into the flow, while the laser Doppler velocimeter does not require a probe to be introduced into the flow. Therefore, it is a non-intrusive method or non-invasive technique for measuring the velocity. However, in the case of laser Doppler measurement, we require some scattering particles to be present in the flow field, and that will be one of the deficiencies for this method. Again, with respect to laser Doppler measurement, we will look at the basic theory, and we will try to look at the typical specifications for an LDV instrument. The first thing I am going to look at is the typical hot wire probe. There are two types of hot wire probes, or hot, one is the hot wire and the other one is the hot film, and let us just look at the way they are constructed. Basically, it consists of a very thin wire, which is shown here between two supports. There are two supports which are going to hold in place the wire, which is usually made of tungsten or platinum, and the fluid which is flowing, whose velocity we want to measure, flows across the tungsten wire, and the wire itself is heated by passing a current through that. And you can very well see that if there is a flow, or if there is a flowing fluid which is passing the tungsten wire, the temperature of the wire or the heat transfer from the wire is going to be dependent on the flow velocity. Therefore, if the flow velocity changes, the tungsten wire experiences a different cooling rate, and based on this we can measure the velocity of the flowing fluid. The length of the tungsten wire is very, very small, short, as shown here. The distance between this point and this point could be a few millimeters, maybe 4 or 5 millimeters, and you can see that this will be less than close to a millimeter or 2 millimeters is the length of the tungsten wire. And usually it is made of very thin wire, and in practice we cannot even, when you look at it, you will not be able to see it with your ordinary eye. You will require to look at it through a microscope to have to verify that the wire is certainly there. Of course, another way of finding out whether the wire is there or not is to find out whether it is a continuity. Electrically, continuity must be there. Okay. So, the reason why we have a support which is shaped in this fashion is to prevent heat transfer through the supports by conduction, or to reduce the heat transfer by conduction through the supports. Because any heat transfer other than from the flowing fluid to the tungsten wire should be as small as possible, so that we have a specific relationship between the flow velocity and the heat transfer rate, which is going to determine the velocity of the flowing fluid. So, in this case, the supports are having some portion which is copper coated, and the length between these two is actually the active length of the hot wire probe. And of course, there is a handle through which the wires which are going to be connected to the tungsten wire are taken out. Basically, the wire is a resistive element, the tungsten wire here or the platinum wire or whichever wire one is going to use, a resistive element. The resistance of the wire changes with temperature. Okay? So, it is similar to the resistance thermometry we talked about earlier. We also talked about a resistance element being used for measurement of pressure. In this case, in the present case, we are looking at the measurement of velocity using the same effect, the thermal effect on a wire whose resistance depends on the temperature. We will get back to the theoretical aspects very soon. Subsequently, I have also shown a typical hot film probe. The difference between the hot film and the hot wire is that the wire is in the form of a thin wire, which is a cylindrical in shape, whereas in the case of a hot film, the material whose resistance is going to vary with temperature is actually coated on a substrate. In this case, you can see that we have platinum film coated on quartz. The quartz tube is here. This is the quartz tube whose diameter is about 0.15 millimeters. The thickness of the coating, the platinum film, is 0.06 millimeters. And there is a certain length here, beyond which there is a gold plating, and the gold plating, the distance between these two points here actually defines the sensor length. The connection to the sensor is taken, one connection is taken through the inside of the tube, and the second connection is taken here, and this supporting tubes are going to make it possible to introduce the hot film into the stream whose velocity I want to measure. You can see that the stream is moving perpendicular or normal to the probe, and the flow is in this direction, and the characteristic of the or the resistance of the probe is dependent on the flow velocity, and the typical hot film probe is going to measure or infer the velocity based on some output, which is going to be an electrical output, and we will look at how the electrical output is going to be related to velocity in a little while from now. The difference between the hot wire and the hot film, there is no difference in terms of the operating principle. The hot wire probe is very delicate because the wire is very small in diameter, very small diameter. We will look at a typical case little later on, and therefore, it is susceptible to damage. Even if you have a very high velocity stream, it can blow off the wire. However, in the case of the hot film, because the film is actually deposited on a substrate, and the substrate itself is a strong material, in this case we have a glass tube or a tube made of quartz, the hot film is more rugged, and therefore, that is one of the major reasons why you go for a hot film probe. The second point is that the hot film can be made very thin, as you see here, and because it is a very thin film, the frequency response of the film also can be made very rapid. It can respond to very rapid fluctuations in the velocity. Of course, the hot wire also will be able to respond to very rapid fluctuations in velocity. And in fact, both the hot film as well as the hot wire probe are in fact used for measurement of turbulent velocities, where the velocity fluctuates with respect to time, and the measurements can be made because the hot wire or the hot film will be able to follow this variation with respect to time. If you recall, when we talked about the pitot tube and so on, they are very slow instruments. They will not be able to rapidly adjust to the changing velocities, and therefore they are basically steady state instruments, instruments useful for measuring steady flow, while the hot film and the hot wire, also the laser Doppler velocimeter we are going to talk about, are useful especially when you want to measure rapid changes in the velocity. Let us look at the theoretical basis of the hot wire anemometer. For this I will use a board. The hot wire essentially consists of a resistance, an electrical resistance, which is nothing but the resistance of the wire. Let me indicate it as RW, that is the resistance, and we pass a current I so that the wire is heated up, is at a temperature TW greater than the fluid temperature, which I will call as T infinity. So, this is the wire temperature and this is the fluid temperature. Suppose I assume that the wire is in the form of a long cylinder, this is the diameter, and we will say this is the length of the probe or the effective length as we have indicated earlier. The flow is taking place perpendicular to with a velocity equal to u, that is the flow which is taking place, and we can in fact see that the, because the current is passing through this, suppose the current is I, the power dissipated by the wire due to this current is I squared R W. I squared R W is the power dissipated. This must be equal to power removed by convection, if we assume that all other modes of heat transfer are important or very negligible, the power removed by convection from the surface. So, in fact, under the steady state condition, so the power dissipated by convection removed by convection is nothing but heat removed by the flow, is nothing but the area of the surface, which will be pi d multiplied by L multiplied by the heat transfer coefficient H multiplied by the temperature difference between the wire and the gas or the flowing fluid. In this case, of course, we are talking about hot wire anemometer, which is used in a gas stream. So, pi d L into H into T W minus T infinity. So, under steady state, we will equate the two. I squared R W must be equal to pi d L into T W minus T infinity multiplied by H. So, the heat transfer coefficient H is a function of u, the velocity. So, normally we invoke what is called the King's law, which is an empirical relation between the heat transfer and the velocity u. So, the heat transfer coefficient is proportional to, is equal to some, let us say, k 1 plus k 2 times square root of u. In fact, in general, square root of u is a specific relationship. In general, I can write it as k 1 plus k 2 times u to the power of n, where the exponent n is very close to half. Of course, depending on the nature of the flow, the size of the wire and so on, the value of n could in fact vary. So, for the moment, let us assume that the relationship is of the form k 1 plus k 2 into u to the power of n. Now, look at this equation, what I have written down. I squared r w equal to pi d l into t w minus t infinity into h. So, we will see that this is the constant determined by the diameter of the wire. This is the length of the wire which is already given. Now, we have on the left hand side, we have the wire resistance, which may be either constant or vary. So, if I actually use the instrument such that the wire temperature remains constant, so this is called the constant temperature anemometer, so CTA, so that is the constant temperature anemometer, that is the first type I am going to discuss. In the case of constant temperature anemometer, TW is constant. Of course, the fluid temperature is given and it is also a constant. So, you see that if the in the case of constant temperature operation, RW is also a constant. RW is a constant. Okay. So, you see that I squared into RW, which is a constant, equal to the product of all these constants times H. Therefore, I can say that I squared is proportional to the heat transfer coefficient. That is what I want to write. And you also realize that if RW is constant, I can do the following. So, in the case of constant temperature anemometer, which I will write it as CTA for constant temperature operation, I squared RW is in the left hand side. I can write it as I squared RW squared divided by RW, which is nothing but the square of the out voltage across the resistance divided by RW. On the right hand side, I have pi d L into T W minus T infinity. These are all constants because T W is maintained constant. How it is maintained constant, we will come to look at it later. Multiplied by H, I am going to write as K 1 plus K 2 u to the power of n. So, I will cross multiply by RW. So, you can see that RW pi DL TW minus T, this all a big constant, that multiplied by K 1 is another constant. Therefore, we can rewrite it as E squared is equal to A plus B u to the power of n. It is a very interesting relationship between the velocity and the output. The E is nothing but the voltage across the resistance, which is considered as the electrical output of the constant temperature anemometer. Obviously, the relationship is nonlinear. And once I measure the value of E under the constant temperature operation of the wire, I can find out what is the corresponding U. In fact, you can write this as you can use the inverse relationship. U is a function of proportional to E, or U is equal to some function of E, we can write. This is the general expression you are going to get, where E is the electrical output. Let us look at the corresponding circuitry of the constant temperature operation. And what I am going to do is to use a bridge circuit, which is familiar to us from our discussion earlier also. The hot wire bridge circuit consists of the following. We have the hot wire sensor which is exposed to the fluid flow velocity. I want to measure. I am calling it R2 here in this sketch. R1 is a standard resistance. R3 and R4 also are standard resistances, and the R1, R2, R3, R4 are connected in the form of a Wheatstone bridge, and I have got a balance detecting galvanometer connected across the bridge here. And if the balance detecting galvanometer shows a 0, it means that the bridge is under balance condition. Just imagine what is happening. I have connected the hot wire sensor in this arm of the bridge, and if I maintain the current, I maintain the temperature constant, whatever may be the velocity here. So, if the velocity goes up, the heat transfer coefficient is going to go up, therefore, it tends to cool the wire, or the temperature difference between the wire and the gas is tending to decrease. So, in order to maintain the temperature, I have to supply more heat so that the temperature remains constant. So, if I want to supply more heat, I have to change the current which is passing through the hot wire, and that is done by the series resistance RS, which is actually operated by a feedback circuit which detects the out of balance here and appropriately takes action to change the RS so that it driven back to balance. It is done electronically by taking a feedback across this balance detecting galvanometer, and that voltage is actually used to control the RS here, such that this is driven to 0, driven to balance condition. So, if it is under balance condition always, that means that the R3, R4, they are fixed resistors, R1 is also fixed. Therefore, R2 is always the same value as long as the balance is maintained, and therefore, the current which I am going to vary by RS, which is also going to, some current is flowing through this the hot wire, that current is going to change. When the current changes, the resistance is the same, the current times the resistance is the voltage across the hot wire sensor, and that is what is measured by this voltmeter. This voltmeter is going to give you the voltage across the, that is what I have shown here. E is the electromagnetic force or the voltage potential difference across the voltmeter, across which actually you have connected the hot wire sensor. So, in the hot wire bridge circuit for constant temperature operation, what I am doing is, I am taking the balance, out of balance voltage, and using it to control the RS by a feedback circuit, so that the current is varied, such that the balance is always maintained. When the balance is always maintained, the four resistors have the same value, fixed value, and therefore, the hot wire is operating under constant resistance or constant temperature condition, because the resistance and temperature are related to each other. Therefore, if the resistance is constant, that means that the temperature must of course be constant. Therefore, the hot wire under constant temperature operation requires a bridge circuit to vary the current through the R2, such that you are going to maintain the balance, and that the voltage appearing across the hot wire is actually a measure of the velocity. And that is what I indicated in the board when I said E squared is equal to A plus B U to the power of n, where A and B are constants, and E is the voltage appearing across the hot wire. It is easy to see that the hot wire can be calibrated, because A and B are two constants to determine. If we have, and in fact n is another constant, and usually n is of the value, n is roughly equal to half for very thin wires. So, if n is fixed at half, A and B can be determined by making two measurements with two different velocities, known velocities being impressed on the hot wire, and then finding out what is the output, and then you can find the values of A and B. So, it is a very simple procedure calibrating the hot wire anemometer. So, to recapitulate what we have done in the board, I have written it here. So, based on King's law, King's law is an empirical relationship obtained by Mr. King long ago. For constant temperature operation, the output is given by E squared equal to A plus B U raised to the power of n. Of course, n is close to half as we have seen. E is the output in volts in this case, use the velocity normal to the wire axis, very important. The velocity should be directed normal to the axis of the wire. If it is not, only that component which is normal to the wire axis is going to give rise to sufficient amount of heat transfer, whereas the parallel, the component which is parallel to it is not going to significantly give rise to any cooling, and therefore it is going to respond to the velocity which is normal to it. A, B and N are constants which can be determined, of course, as I indicated, by suitable calibration technique. Let us look at the hot wire bridge circuit for constant current operation. And before we look at this constant current operation case, let me go back to the board and look at what is the possibility we can have. So, if I go back to the equation here, I squared R w equal to pi d L into T w minus T infinity h. If I keep I constant, so you can see that first time I kept the R w constant. So, I am going to now consider that as a variable. This is constant, and you can also see that this is not a constant anymore. This is not a constant anymore, and therefore, both the current is kept constant, this is not constant, this is going to vary. If this varies, this also varies. So, I will just indicate by a plus sign there or a multiplication sign there, which means that this is going to vary, this is also going to vary, and of course, h is going to vary with velocity given by the same relationship, the King's law. And in fact, we can show that if this is the case, I will go back to my slide here, and in fact, we can show that based on the same King's law, for constant current operation, the output is given by an equation of this form, E naught minus E equal to A u raised to the power of n divided by 1 plus B u raised to the power of n, where A and B are constants, n is an index which is also a constant, may be half, may be different value. E 0 is the value of the output when the velocity is equal to 0. When there is no flow, whatever value you are going to get is the E naught, and the E is the value you are going to get when there is a stream of velocity u flowing perpendicular to the axis of the wire. And therefore, E naught minus E equal to A u raised to the power of n divided by 1 plus B u raised to the power of n. Now, let us look at this equation slightly more carefully. Before we do that, let me go back to the previous one. We said E square equal to A plus B u to the power of n. In this case, the temperature is constant. What is the advantage of a constant temperature operation? Number one, of course, the resistance, the hot wire itself is going to be maintained more or less at a constant temperature throughout its operation, and therefore, it is not subject to any temperature cycling, and because of that, it will be possible to have a long life for the hot wire, because the hot wire or the hot film, it is not going to be subjected to any thermal cycling, because the temperature remains fixed, and therefore, that is a plus point as far as the constant temperature operation is concerned. In the case of constant current operation, of course, the relationship looks more complicated. In this case, you will see that the value of E, as u increases, you can see that E will come to the right hand side. If you take this left hand side, E actually reduces. Why does it reduce? Because I am keeping a constant current. If I go back to the figure here, I am going to maintain a constant current through the resistance. When the current is constant, if the hot wire is going to be subjected to a higher velocity fluid flowing across it, its temperature will come down, because it is going to be cooled by a higher heat transfer coefficient. Okay? And therefore, the hot wire is going to reduce in temperature, and the hot wire material, it has a resistance coefficient such that the resistance will reduce when the temperature reduces. So, when the R w or the wire resistance decreases, the voltage across this is going to decrease, and that is what is indicated by the relationship which is given here. E naught minus E equal to A e to the power of n divided by 1 plus B e to the power of n indicates clearly that as U increases, the output E actually comes down. So, before we take a look at the performance, we will take a look at a typical case of a hot wire anemometer for which the specifications are given here, and the specifications I have taken from the website of the manufacturer www.topak.com. This is only a typical hot wire anemometer. Okay. So, the flow range is 0.1 to 10 meter per second, that is the range of operation of this instrument. So, 0.1 meter per second is the lowest, and 10 meter per second. You actually cannot measure temperature, velocity is much lower than this anyway, it is very difficult. So, the accuracy is plus or minus 0.21 meter per second, plus minus 1% reading from plus 5 to 45. This is the temperature of the fluid whose velocity you are measuring. Within the range 5 to 45, it has got plus or minus 0.12 meter per second, plus or minus 1% of the reading. However, it goes up to plus or minus 0.2, plus minus 2% reading, minus 20 to plus 5, as well as plus 45 to 70. So, the range of operation of the instrument is of course minus 20 to 70 degrees for the temperature of the fluid which is flowing. So, the operating temperature of the hot wire itself is 0 to 50 degrees. The operating temperature generally is 0 to 50 degrees centigrade. The probe tip itself is minus 20 to plus 80. That is the temperature range in this particular case. Some hot wire anemometers, or many hot wire anemometers which use either platinum element or a tungsten element, operate at around 200 degrees Celsius. That is the normal value which is used. In this case, he is using minus 20 to plus 80. This is the probe tip temperature variation. The probe length is 300 millimeters, so that it can be introduced into the flow. Probe diameter, or the diameter of the probe, is 13 millimeters. Dimensions you can see here, and the weight is about 250 grams. It's a very small handheld instrument. It can be introduced into the flow, and this is a very easy way of measuring the velocity. In practice, what we do is, when we are not sure about the direction of the velocity, we can change the direction of the probe and find out when you get the maximum value. When the output is maximum, and you can see that where that happens when the velocity of the fluid is exactly normal to the direction the probe, and therefore you can roughly find out the direction of the flow also if you by maximizing the output. So, with this background, let us take a look at a typical case of a hot wire anemometer. The hot wire operates at a temperature of 200 degrees Celsius, and the air temperature is 20 degrees. The velocity of air may vary between 0 and 10 meter per second. The hot wire element is a platinum wire of 4 millimeter diameter, this is 4 micrometer diameter, and 1.2 millimeter length. You have to correct it, this 4 micrometers. And what is the sensor output when the air velocity is 4 meter per second? That is what we want to find out. So, I will work out the problem on the board. So, this is the example 29. See the wire diameter, I will just write down what are the given micrometer. In the slide it is mm, actually it is a mistake, it is micrometer. The length of the probe is 1.2 millimeters, and it is a operating temperature which is TW in our earlier nomenclature is 200 degrees Celsius. The temperature of the air whose velocity we are measuring is 20 degrees. So, TW and T infinity are specified, and we are assuming constant temperature operation, CT operation, which is more common because of the obvious reason that the hot wire is not going to be subjected to too much of thermal cycling. And the thermal coefficient, the alpha, which is the coefficient of resistance, temperature coefficient of resistance of platinum, is 0.00392, which we already know from our RTD experience. Per degree Celsius, and then the resistivity of platinum at 20 degrees is given as 10.5 into 10 to the power of minus 8 ohms meter. These are all the characteristics of the. So, we can calculate actually the resistance of the wire. Just to find out what are the typical values you meet with in practice. For that, I require the resistivity at 200 degrees, which is given by rho at 20 into 1 plus alpha times Tw minus T20 happens to be also T infinity. So, this is the thing. So, all I have to do is to substitute the values 10 to the power of 10.5. multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 8 into 1 plus 0.00392 into Tw minus T infinity is 200 minus 20 is 180, and this comes out to be 17.91 into 10 to the power of minus 8 ohm meter. So, based on the resistivity of the material, I can calculate the resistance of the wire is nothing but rho at 200 multiplied by L divided by A, and rho at 200 multiplied by L divided by pi d squared by 4. So, we can just substitute all the values. So, rho 200 is 17.91 into 10 to the power of minus 8, L is 1.2 millimeters, so I will convert it to meters, divided by pi by 4 into d is 4 micrometers, so 4 into 10 to the power of minus 6 whole square. This comes to 17.1 ohms. So, you see that the wire resistance, such a small wire, very thin wire, has got a resistance of 17.1 ohms. Now, I can use the King's law, and empirically it has been determined that the Nusselt number is given by a relation to the form C1 plus C2 times square root of Re, based on the diameter of the wire, where C1 for operation in air, C1 is equal to 0.3 and C2 is equal to 0.362. So, this information is empirical relationship from heat transfer theory. So, I am going to use this Nusselt number. From the Nusselt number, I can calculate the heat transfer coefficient. So, that is the idea. But for this calculation, I require to calculate the Reynolds number, and the Reynolds number can be calculated at a mean temperature of air equal to the mean between the temperature of the wire and temperature of the fluid. That will be Tw plus T infinity divided by 2. It will come to 110 degrees. Celsius. 200 plus 20 divided by 2, that will give you 110 degrees Celsius. And from air tables, the properties required may be written down. And let us look at the properties. What are the properties required? I require the kinematic viscosity for calculating the Reynolds number, 24.15 into 10 to the power of minus 6 meter square per second. Then I require the G subscript G is just to say it is the gas property or the air property. Kg is the thermal conductivity, which comes to 0.032 watts per meter Kelvin, and the Prandtl number, which is 0.7. All these are going to play a role. But the way I have given the King's law, the Prandtl number is not going to explicitly come. It is already built into it, and therefore, we need not have this. This value is not important from the point of view of calculations which we are going to give out. So, if I calculate the Reynolds number based on the diameter, I am going to take u is equal to 4 meter per second. If you remember, the problem said find out what is the output when the velocity is 4 meter per second. So, RED will be nothing but u d by nu g. This will be 4 into 4 into 10 to the power of minus 6. This is 4 micrometers divided by 24.15 into 10 to the power of minus 6, and this value is 0.667. Reynolds number is very, very small. Okay. So, this information has to be used in determining the Nusselt number, and the heat transfer coefficient, if you remember, Nusselt number based on diameter is h multiplied by d divided by kg, and NUD is equal to C1 plus C2 square root of 0.667. This is the Reynolds number. So, if I use this, this gives you 0.596, and I have to get the heat transfer coefficient 0.596 multiplied by 0.032 is the gas conductivity divided by diameter is 4 into the power of minus 6. The heat transfer coefficient turns out to be 4768 watts per square meter Kelvin. The heat transfer coefficient turns out to be 4768, and now I can calculate. Now that I know all the quantities, the heat transfer coefficient, the diameter, the length, and the temperature, which is also given, so I can find out what is the heat transferred from the wire when it is exposed to a stream at 4 meters per second. You have pi d L h into T w minus T g or T w minus T infinity. This will be pi into 4 into 10 to the power of minus 6 into 1.2 into 10 to the power of minus 3 into 180. This will be 0.013 watts. So, 13 milliwatts is what I am going to be dissipating at 4 meters per second. When the velocity of the fluid is 4 meter per second, I am going to have about 13 milliwatts of heat which is being rejected, and this must be equal to the electrical input. Therefore, I can immediately find out what is the potential difference required. So, the corresponding current I also can calculate, and in fact, I will directly calculate the output E will be nothing but the Q divided by RW. Q is nothing but the electrical dissipation divided by RW. That will give you, actually you can just substitute the values, and this will give you a value of 0.47 volts. So, the voltage output is given by 0.47 watts. If I look at the, if I vary the velocity of the fluid from the lowest possible to 10 meter per second, that is the range given in the problem, I can in fact calculate the value of E for each velocity and make a sketch, and in fact, I have done that here. So, let us look at the sketch. You can see that the output volts I have plotted on the y axis, on the x axis I have got the velocity in meter per second, and you can see that 4 meter per second the value is 0.47, and if I vary the velocity from 0 to 10 meter per second, I get a relationship which is actually a nonlinear relationship. And normally what we would like to do is, if it is possible to make it a linear relationship, it will be good. And that can be done by the following method. I will just indicate on the board again. So, how do you linearize? If you remember, we had e squared equal to a plus b u to the power of n, and a is nothing but u e naught squared. When u equal to 0, a will be simply nothing but the output, which is going to be e naught squared. So, we can say that e squared minus e naught squared equal to b u to the power of n. I will divide throughout by e naught squared, and therefore, I will get the following. So, e squared by e naught squared minus 1 equal to b by e naught squared u to the power of n. So, I will just call it k u to the power of n, because b by e naught squared is another constant. So, if I take the logarithms of this, log of e by e naught whole squared minus 1, this will be logarithm of k some constant plus n log u. So, if I plot logarithm of this quantity versus logarithm of u, I will get a straight line, and that is in fact what is done on the in the slide. I am going to show how the linearization can be done, and that is what happens. You have a linear output. The velocity is now, instead of putting it on the x axis, I have put the velocity on the y axis. And if you see here, I have plotted the logarithm, I have used logarithm scale on the x axis and the y axis, and therefore, the value of velocity goes from, of course, I cannot go to 0 in the logarithm scale. 0 will become minus infinity, it is not possible to show it here. Therefore, I am showing it from some value close enough to 0. Okay? So, you can see that the relationship is actually linear. The advantage of this is that you can simply read off from here. Of course, it is a linearized, but it is not really linear relationship. It is linearized on the log-log graph. And in fact, you will be able to notice that the slope of this curve is actually related to n. In this case, of course, n equal to half. If it is not equal to half, by making a plot like this, one must be able to find out what is the value of n in the case. I am not going to go through the calculation for a CC mode operation. I have already given the relationship between the velocity and the output. If we make a plot of that for a typical case, a length of wire is 100 micrometer, a very short wire, and resistance at room temperature is 2000 ohms, a very short, very thin wire. And if you plot the variation of output voltage V as a function of velocity, you see that I indicated that it will be a maximum at zero velocity, because it is at zero velocity, it is the resistance is highest, the current is constant, therefore, it is going to give you a large output. And as the velocity increases, the temperature of the probe is going to come down, it is going to reduce, and therefore, the resistance is going to reduce, and therefore, what I get is a reduced output. And the output is again nonlinear, and this is given by 1 minus, if you remember, a u to the power of n divided by 1 plus b to the power of u to the power of n, which I gave earlier. So, with this, we will have covered some ideas about hot wire anemometry. There are many important details which we cannot cover in this particular time, because it is outside the scope of an elementary discussion on the hot wire anemometer. It can in fact be used for determining the velocities and also the fluctuating velocities in a turbulent flow field, the direction and so on. It is beyond the scope of the present scheme of lectures. So, those things can be learnt from more advanced books on measurement techniques. So, what I will do now is to look at the use of laser Doppler velocimetry or the measurement of velocity using lasers. So, before I go into that, let me just describe a typical system which is used for laser Doppler measurement. After discussing that system, then I will go and look at the basic operational principle. So, what I have here is what is called a fringe system. Again, there are two ways of using the laser Doppler anemometer. There is a Doppler velocimeter, two different ways of arrangement. One is called the fringe system and the other one is called the reference beam system. So, what I am going to discuss now is the fringe system. So, I have a laser source and I have got a beam splitter. What does a beam splitter do? It produces from a single laser beam, it produces two beams, one moving in this direction, the other one reflected off, and this is going to hit a mirror and it is going to be made into a beam which is parallel to the old beam, but slightly away from the beam which started. From a given laser beam, I am creating two laser beams, one here and the other one here. The idea is to split it into two beams. And these two beams are going to be condensed by a lens to a spot at this point. So, these two beams are going to make cross at this point. There are two beams, one here and the other one here. These two beams are from the same source. Originally, they come from the same laser source. Therefore, they have a coherent relationship between each other. So, the phase relationship between the laser beam 1 and laser beam 2 is such that they start with the same phase. And therefore, these two beams are going to, when they cross at this spot here, it can be brought to very small spot by focusing. At this spot, it is going to form a set of fringes. And the fringes I have schematically shown here in the form of a diamond shaped region. It is a very small narrow region. This is a very highly exploded view of what is happening at that place. You have closed spaced fringes. A large number of fringes are being formed because of the different path lengths of each ray of light which is here and here because of that. And they are coming at an angle of theta with respect to each other, and because of the phase relationship, they form a set of dark and bright fringes. And what I am going to do is, I am going to have some kind of a particle in the flow. I am going to introduce some particle into the flow, so that the particle will, when it moves through this fringe field, is going to scatter the radiation. And the scattered radiation, whenever it is in the bright part of the fringe field, it will give you a bright image, and when it moves into the shadow or the dark part of the fringe, it will give you no radiation. So, I must have particles which are smaller than the spacing between the fringes, because if they are big particles, they will not be able to do anything, because they will just go through and some part of the particle or the other will be reflecting the light all the time or scattering the light, and therefore, it is useless. So, the particles must be really small, so that they are smaller than the fringe spacing. We will see little later what is the fringe spacing, order of magnitude of the value of the fringe spacing. So, if you have very small diameter particles moving across this fringe field, and if these particles are present in the flowing medium, and if we assume that these particles are so small that they are moving almost with the same velocity as the velocity of the gas in which it is going to be present, then the pattern of reflection when it passes through this contains the information about the velocity of the particle capital C. It is the particle velocity, and we are assuming that the particle velocity is same as the gas velocity, and therefore, the velocity of the gas is inferred from the pattern of reflected light or the light scattered by the particles which cross the fringe field. You can imagine the fringe field to be something like a set of fence posts. You have parallel post, and suppose a person is walking behind the fence, you will see him sometime, you will not see him sometime. Okay? There is a periodicity to the image you obtain. So, if he walks very fast, this periodicity will become very small, period will become small, and if he walks very far, very slowly, it will become larger. Therefore, the frequency with which the variation, frequency with which this scattered image varies depends on the velocity. It is directly related to the velocity, given that the fringe spacing remains constant. Like in the case of fences, the fence posts are at constant intervals. Okay. So, the principle is very simple. You just find out, you collect the light which is scattered. You can see here that I have scattered light alone I am collecting. The main beam, the two beams which are going to cause are now stopped here. They are not going to fall onto the detector. The photomultiplier tube here is going to give you a burst signal. So, let us look at the signal, what it is going to be like. It is like going to be like this. The signal is going to be like this. When the particle moves across the fringe field, it is going to give you a burst signal like this, and when there are no particles, there is no signal. And if I filter the signal, I will get a waveform like this, and this waveform I have to find out what is the frequency which is contained in it, and that frequency is related to the velocity of the particle which is moving through the fringe field. So, if I look at the formula, I can write it the following way. Lambda is the wavelength of the laser radiation. In the little later we will look at the order of magnitude of this value. The frequency obtained from the burst signal is f, and the velocity v is the velocity component normal to the fringes. You can see here that the fringe field is shown as a set of parallel lines, and the particle is moving at an angle. Only this component is going to be important, because you will not get information about the velocity in this direction. You will get the component in this direction, and you can see that the velocity is nothing but the frequency of the burst signal multiplied by the distance between the fringes, and the distance between the fringes can be obtained from, let us say, the theory of optical theory related to interference of light, that is given by lambda by 2 sin theta by 2. And let us go back to the previous figure. Theta is the full angle, theta by 2 is actually the half angle, the angle between these two, half angle, and the fringe spacing is given by lambda divided by 2 divided by sin theta by 2 multiplied by f. This is the velocity. So, the velocity can be inferred by measuring the frequency of the burst signal. So, the burst signal frequency has to be determined by using electronic signal processing, so that you can get the velocity of the particle which is moving across the fringe field. So, this is one way of using the laser Doppler velocimeter, that is to use the fringe. In this case we have used what is called the fringe system by crossing two beams and allowing them to interfere and form a set of fringes. The subsequent one, the second one, uses the reference beam technique, and I will take it up in the next lecture. Thank you. Thank you.